even though the topic might feel a little dry, it's kind of like when you have to come up with your thesis in school for a book report. You kind of roll your eyes and you're like, oh, do I have to think about this? But I'm here to tell you that I just went through this the last year. I've had a brand for 7 years on YouTube. And the last year, I did a lot of soul searching, and I really needed to get into redefining what my niche actually was. And I can honestly say it is fun, it's entertaining, and it's very enlightening. So with that, I'm gonna get into this. So why create a niche? So when I was putting these slides together, I couldn't help think of The Little Prince, one of my favorite children's books, and the part where he has his rose, and he's watering it and nurturing it, and his rose is unique in all the world. And I kept thinking this is how, as content creators, we can feel about our brands and about our blogs and whatever it is we're putting out there. We kind of get into our little bubble. We think, you know, our content is the best, our pictures are fantastic, what's not to love? And we kind of stay in this bubble. And I think it's really important to look outside of that and to communicate a niche, because to everybody else, we can just look like a bunch of roses. They don't really see how we're different from anybody else. And I think if you spend any time on Pinterest scrolling through that feed, after a while, it all starts to look like the same chia pudding. Like, it really does start to blend. And so I think it's very important to communicate why you're doing what you're doing and not just the what. And we're going to get into that in a second. So we are all in a scale game. Like, everybody wants to try to get the most amount of followers, the most amount of page views, and it's easy to think everybody in the tent. Like, my content is for everybody. But I think if you really spent time thinking about it, you would probably come to realize it probably isn't for everybody. And like, that's okay. So in 2012, I launched my brand, Entertaining with Beth, on YouTube. And I just kind of set out creating videos for people like me. So busy moms who had kids who just like to entertain. Well, we'll just start there. And I'm going to show you my trailer video. So on YouTube, it's very common to have a trailer video that kind of tells people what your channel is all about. So I want to show you what it looked like in 2012. My biggest priority on Entertaining with Beth is to empower people to invite friends over and cook for them. If you ask me, there is no greater joy in life than to welcome our friends into our home and cook them a beautiful meal. But I'm a busy mom of two kids with a full-time job, so I don't have the luxury of spending all day in the kitchen. My motto is minimum effort for maximum impact. So even if you don't have all day to spend in the kitchen, you can make it look as though you did. So if you want to learn how to entertain in style, subscribe to my channel, Entertaining with Beth, and I'll teach you how to pull it all off like a seasoned pro. So that was fine for a while. I had that trailer video for 6 years. But I realized that as the space became more competitive, you know, back in 2011, when there was a lot of funded channels on YouTube, there weren't a ton of cooking channels. But I feel like between 2011 and now, there are so many cooking channels. It's very competitive, but it still doesn't mean that there isn't room for new people. Like, I think people sometimes feel YouTube is like, oh, there's no time, and oh, it's too hard. It's not too hard. I see people launch channels every year that have great success. So for any of you thinking about video and YouTube, come on in. Water's great. So I was targeting busy moms, but to me, it was still too broad, because isn't every mom busy? Like, basically, I was going after all moms, so that wasn't really a niche. And cooking and entertaining was still kind of too broad. They're really more categories. They're not actually a niche, and I think that was what I really discovered this last year. So when I really thought about it, I thought, okay, I have to look to the audience. And one of the things that's so great about all the platforms we're on is they provide such metrics. You can know exactly who is looking at your content and where they live. And by reading the comments and looking at the engagement, you also can get into their psyche a little bit and find out more about them. So I spent a good year really diving into who was consuming my content across all my platforms. And it was one of the most rewarding processes for me, because while I was targeting middle-aged women, I was actually attracting millennial nesters. So I call them nesters because they're the women who have just, you know, moved in with their boyfriend and they're sort of buying their first KitchenAid mixer, or it's the women who just got married and received everything on their registry but they don't know what to do with it. And suddenly they're at this life stage where they need to have the first Thanksgiving, baby shower for the college roommate, book club. They're expected to cook and entertain. And I found that I was not speaking to these women. I was just sort of speaking to whoever would listen, and kind of like moms and busy. But I realized there's a real opportunity to speak to them, because I've been doing all of this for 20 years. I was married 20 years ago. I was that first-time bride. I was a nester. I know what some of those challenges were. I've hosted 15 Thanksgivings. Like, I actually had something to say to people who were new and just coming into this. And that's where I really had this aha moment. So cooking for busy moms suddenly became cooking for millennial nesters hosting their first Thanksgiving in a cramped apartment who are cash-strapped and time-starved and in a panic because they've never done it before and they want to look like rock stars in front of their in-laws and so they can show it all off on Instagram. So that's really a niche for somebody. Like, there is a person behind that thought. And I think that had really helped me to succeed so that I was able to quit my full-time job. So I launched this when I had a full-time job working 40 to 50 hours a week, two kids, two-hour commute, did that for 6 years. And through the process of really refining my niche, I was able to earn enough money to quit the full-time job. And I think that that was testament enough of how important it is to really know who you're speaking to and speak directly to them. Now, there are pros and cons of going uber niche. I think, you know, you do leave people out of the tent. Like, it's not for everybody. But I find that that's okay, because I think, like, the internet's just too big. Like, you're never gonna reach everybody anyway. Like, I think the media companies do that really well. So if you're Genius Kitchen or if you're Food Network, like, they have to try to reach everybody all the time. Like, they are definitely a big scale game. But we don't have to play that game. First of all, we can't afford to play that game. That game's really expensive. And second of all, we have the freedom to get more niche than that and to speak directly to somebody and in the process develop a much tighter emotional connection with our audience. Okay, so how do you then take that and leverage it with brands? And this is where it's been really interesting for me in the last few years to see how knowing an audience actually has made me more competitive in a space that is very competitive. So I have found that the niche is attractive to brands for a couple of reasons. One, brand content is so competitive. It's competitive with the brands to get the influencers. It's competitive with the influencers against each other. And to them, we all look like that page of all the roses. It's really hard for brands who are up against deadlines. They have deadlines and campaigns to activate to really get to know our brand. But if you have a niche, you start to become an expert in an audience. And that's where I found brands really kind of clued in, because brands, yes, they're selling products, but they also have campaign objectives. They know they need to reach women 18 to 34, millennial. Like, they actually have that all figured out. And if you can say, hey, guess what? I reach that audience and I do this category, it starts to become more meaningful to them. Because yes, they want to sell products, but they also want to win hearts and minds. They're trying to get that brand loyalty of people who are going to buy a Le Creuset pot when they're newly married, and they're gonna always buy those pots because suddenly they now have their brand loyalty. So it's important for them to win a heart and mind of their user. So I found that I was able to sell this expertise, and suddenly I was not just another food creator for them. I was somebody who was targeting millennial women who were entertaining for the first time in a life stage that was very important for advertisers and for brands. They wanna get them right at that life stage where they're creating their brand loyalties. So I had a really interesting case study that I wanted to share with you guys, because I think you could just show how far-reaching this really can be. So a couple years ago, I had Bissell Vacuums come to me. I'm a food entertaining channel. I'm like, Bissell Vacuums? Like, what am I going to do with a vacuum? And they said, yeah, we get your food channel, but that's okay. We actually don't care. We are interested in reaching these millennial nesters, and you know this community really well. So we have this cordless vacuum, which is really good for people living in the cities, and we just want you to create content that you think this audience would care about. I was like, oh, wow, okay. And I said, well, you know, a lot of these people are just entertaining for the first time. I think we should create a video series around holiday helpers. So, you know, three appetizers you can do with store-bought puff pastry, or how to get your house ready for the holidays. I think this would really resonate. I'm like, okay, great. And because they were looking to me as the expert in the audience, they really stayed out of it. And so there's only like one vacuum shot and co-branded title cards. And in a video integration, like, that was so refreshing because of my channel. Like, it would have been weird to have more than one vacuum shot. But it generated over 1 million video views for the brand. And it's the gift that keeps on giving. Even this last Q4, it generated 150,000 additional views because the content had resonated. So I think that that is definitely a good point when you're speaking to brands to explain, like, you do know the content and you know the category, but you also know the audience and you know what is going to resonate with them. And that years later, in the long tail analysis of views, it will continue to generate views for the brand. Okay, now we're gonna talk a little bit about a tribe, and I'm sure that you guys spend a lot of time with this because this is not a new concept to any of you, but I have found that it is even more powerful when you tap into kind of the human experience that we are all a part of. So we're gonna get a little psychological here. So I think the technology is great. Yes, it has connected us in a way that we've never been connected before. But I also find that it's kind of disconnected us in a way, because there's so much on social media, especially Facebook and Instagram, that sometimes we don't actually need to reach out to our friends and family because we've already kind of seen their updates on Facebook. And I think that it's also kind of given us this weird feeling of needing to connect in a human way that we're not doing because we're not connecting in real life a lot of the time. So I don't know if any of you are familiar with Abraham Maslow's hierarchy of needs. He was a psychologist in the 1940s, and he created this pyramid, which looks like this. And the need to belong is the third need on the pyramid. It comes right after needing food, water, safety, and security. So that is a huge need. And I think us building brands online and creating communities and creating tribes, like, we can tap into that, because that is what people are looking for. They are looking for people that they can connect with. And our brands, our values, and what we put out there into the world will attract people because they believe what we believe, and they want to be a part of how we see the world. And I don't think that that's new, and that's kind of the refreshing part of it. So I think it's also led to this tribe mentality of, where are my people? Because the internet is so big, it can also feel really lonely. Yes, it's connecting us, but it also feels like a big sea, and you're kind of trying to connect with people that think the same way that you do. And so while a niche is a business strategy, I also think it works because you're tapping into a human need that's always been there. I had another interesting campaign with Swanson a few years ago. I don't know if you remember, but they were doing these ad campaigns that were all around "This is why I cook." And the tagline that they were using were things like, "To share moments, to remember my grandmother, to travel without leaving home." And they had been watching my channel and saw that I was sharing recipes from my grandmother, that I was sharing moments that I enjoyed with my kids, and that these recipes had had special meaning for us. A lot of the recipes also are inspired by my in-laws in France. So they said, "You know what, you believe what we believe. We think we can create content around these shared values." And had I not done that, had I just been making my recipes and not sharing that vulnerable part of me, the brand would have never seen that. And I was a pretty small channel at the time, and we did a three-part video series that was very lucrative for me at the time, but I think it speaks to this idea of small being the new big. So even if you're a small creator, if you have a very engaged audience and you can align with a brand on shared values, it starts to become really meaningful for everybody. Okay, so if you have a niche, and you just want to niche down further, I think that's also possible. And it's something that I actually think is healthy to look at, maybe once a year, making sure your niche still rings true. Has anybody read this book, Primal Branding? No? Nobody? Oh my gosh, it's a great book. Don't Let the Freaky Photo Fool You. I've read this book maybe four times now, and every time I look at that photo and I'm like, why is that on the cover of this book? I don't get it. So Don't Let the Freaky Photo Fool You. The book is actually really, really good. And if you get it on Audible, it's also really entertaining to listen to, and then you don't have to look at the freaky photo. But the thesis of this book is the most powerful brands create community based on believers. So if we look at some of the brands that we all love, you can think about what their belief system is. So if you look at Nike, just do it. So if you like to exercise, if you like to be healthy, there are times when you're trying to reach your fitness goals that you just have to do it, you gotta power through. And it can be exercise or it can be in life. Apple, thinking differently is okay. Like, there's definitely times when we've sat around the table arguing a PC versus an Apple, and the people who believe in Apple really believe in Apple. IKEA, good design doesn't have to be expensive. So I think that shows how brands can have believers as opposed to just selling products. And I think that that can be said for content creators as well. Like, we need to have belief systems that people buy in to what we believe, and that's how you can create a really powerful community. So while cooking and DIY and home decor is what we do, I think our niche is why we do it. And that is where the soul searching comes in. I think it was really interesting this morning when it was brought up about pursuing your kind of heart's desire and like what you want to do, what is that seed of purpose? And I think this business is so hard that if you don't have that seed of purpose, that is what gets you through kind of the hard times of all of this content creation. For me, why do I do this? Why do I spend so much time, money, and effort like creating videos and optimizing and going through all of this? It's because I really do believe that food has the power to change relationships. I think sitting around a table, sharing a meal, it creates memories, it creates lasting moments, it creates safety in a family. Like, there's so many great things that I've seen in my life come from that. And I know that other people also believe that out there. And so by putting myself out there and communicating that to the world, I attract other people that believe that. And then together, we kind of create this very strong community around this shared belief. And everything I do, that is then infused into the content. And the niche then becomes the creed, which this is where I think it keeps yourself honest when you're creating content. It keeps the community accountable for what kind of people are posting or the messages that they're sending. And it's as simple as putting out, here's what I care about. Here's why it matters to me. Do you believe that? Great. Welcome aboard. You know, that is kind of at the very core, the basis of it. And I also love this concept of how the niche can really have your back, especially when you're doing brand content. And I think we've probably all been in those experiences where things are going great and then the brand asks you to do something and you're like, not so much. And that's when you can really fall back on this niche and this idea of the believers and what we believe and what we don't believe. As simple as, we don't believe that, we don't talk like that, we don't think like this or act like that around here. It's sort of against our creed. And I had this theory put to the test this winter when I had a brand come to me and wanted me to create some holiday content. Great, came up with a recipe with all systems go. And at the very last minute they said, you know, it's very important to the brand that you dress your table in jewel tones. I was like, jewel tones? Yes, they want to see crimson reds and sapphire blues and emeralds. And I was like, And if you've seen my content, like, I don't really do jewel tones. It's more like California muted tones. And at the end of the day, I was like, you know, my audience is not going to relate to that. And when I asked them why it was important to do jewel tones, they said, oh, because that's the colors of the logo. I was like, oh, you know, like, so I just thought that is like not, that's just not going to work. So I had to like say no to that brand, but it was a lot easier to say no to say, you know what, we don't believe that that is what a holiday table should look like, we're going to have to pass, as opposed to like, I don't think I can do that. Like suddenly you have the army of your community and what you believe to say, that's not right for us. So if you're thinking of going down this road and you think it might be time for a little brand refresh, I think it's really helpful to look at the kind of who, what, where, and why questions. It's super simple. It's something that you can do on your ride home. Get out a notepad. I think the who really comes down to who is the content for, and really think of a person, not just a group. So there is a person who you are talking to, and give the person a name. Sometimes that can even be helpful. And whenever you are creating content, think of that person. Does this make sense for this person? What will they come if they get here? What's the value proposition? So what's the problem that you're trying to solve? Like, how can your niche actually help people live in a better way? Where did the leader come from? So I think that there is kind of an interesting discussion online right now between how much do you share about yourself and how much do you share content that's going to do well SEO search engine. And I think it's definitely a balance for every creator. I think some people share more personal stuff and they're comfortable with that. And some people share more, you know, SEO kind of strategy stuff. For me, I think it was very important for me to realize that I had to share my origin story. I had to share where I came from, why I'm doing what I'm doing, because I realized when I did that, people saw themselves in me. And I think there's nothing like human connection when you connect with a person because you see yourself somewhere in there. That is a really strong tie. So I would not underestimate the power of an origin story, especially if you're just beginning, because they will remember how you began and they will be part of your journey and also part of your success. And when people feel that they have a hand in your success, they're even more invested because they put their personal investment in your success and they kind of feel like they had a part in it. And that's also, I think, really powerful. So why? And this is where we get into that belief structure. So I think you will all really enjoy that book. You should definitely read it because it talks a lot about how you get to your why. What do you both believe and what do you both value? And that's just so important. Because I think that at the end of the day is what makes all of this sustainable. If you're putting content out there because you think it's gonna rank, you know, on the first page of Google or because other people are doing it and it's successful for them and you don't have that seed of purpose, like that becomes really hard to be sustainable. Because if you don't believe it somewhere, and we have all had these moments where these brands, they will take us to the brink. And we have all been in the fetal position about to give up. But that is what keeps you going, is because you really believe something and you really think that there is a purpose to creating what you're creating. And this is also your best defense mechanism because no two people are alike. No two people believe the same thing. We all have different points of view about food and home. And I think putting it out there just tells people that we are all different. We don't look like that page of roses. Okay, so with that, I wanted to share with you my new trailer video so you can see how I've incorporated many of these things into this video. Are you just learning to cook? Do you long to invite friends over and effortlessly present them with a beautiful meal? I'm Beth Le Manach, and 20 years ago, that was me. I fell in love with a charming Frenchman, and I knew that I had to step up my cooking game. So I honed my skills cooking every day, 3 meals a day, until I got the hang of it. I quickly realized that food had the power to connect people in a way that nothing else did. People felt cared for and special. Cooking for me has always been the sincerest form of love. Eventually, we had 2 beautiful children, and I continue to cook 3 meals a day, every single day, perfecting recipes to share with all of you. From quick and easy weeknight meals to holiday favorites, and of course, a show-stopping dessert or two. On this channel, I'll always give you the simplest path to success, share my tips and tricks for foolproof results, break down the prep into manageable steps, and most of all, show you how to make every meal a beautiful meal, because I believe the details matter. I'll share recipes with you that have meant something to me and my family over the years in hopes that one day they'll mean something to you and your family. So if you want to learn how to create more meaningful connections with the people you love, subscribe to my channel, Entertaining with Beth, and I'll show you why food always tastes better when shared.
Yeah, check that. So you can see it's a lot more heartfelt. I mean, you know more about me, you know more about what you're gonna get when you come to the channel, and this video has performed so much better for me than my old trailer video. Only because I'm speaking to one person. You can tell, I'm speaking to somebody, and the people who see that and think I'm speaking right to them are like, oh my gosh, yes, subscribe. This is me, this is what I need, where I didn't have that with the other video. So it's definitely a fun project, exploring your niche and redefining your niche, and I hope some of these ideas have been helpful to get you to think about it. I think it's definitely time worth spent for your brand. So anyway, that's all I got.